Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Digitalks. My name is Alex Kenning, and I am the Managing Director of Aquent Australia. And I'm going to open this event with an acknowledgement of country. Aquent acknowledges the traditional owners of country throughout Australia and recognises their continuing connection to lands, waters, and communities. We pay our respect to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander cultures and to elders both past and present. Now, for those of you who don't know Aquent, we are a global workforce solutions company that helps organizations find, grow, and support their most valuable resource, which is people. So to today's Digitalks, this is now our seventh year of proudly supporting and sponsoring UX Australia. And it's the second time that we have had an Aquent and Digitalks feature at the event. And what is super exciting is that this Digitalks is looking like being the biggest ever. We have had almost 1,400 RSVPs, which is fantastic. Before we get into it, I have a few housekeeping bits and pieces to run through. Closed captions are enabled for this webinar. You can turn them on at the bottom of your screen. Throughout the presentation, Hamish and Jonathan will be posing some questions to the audience. Please use the chat panel that you can see at the bottom of your screen to answer these questions, and do answer quickly, as Jonathan and Hamish will be responding live to the answers that you give. We will also have a Q&A session at the end. So if you do have any questions, please put those in the Q&A tab throughout the event, and we'll get to those at the end. You can also upvote people's questions as well. If there's something you like, you can upvote that to get it to the top. A recording of this will be emailed to everybody. And at the end of the webinar, we would love your feedback. So there will be a feedback form. Please do fill that in. That is all from me, but let me introduce today's speakers. We have Hamish O'Neill, who is the head of design systems at carsales.com.au and was previously design lead of ANZ's brand and design system. And we have Jonathan Stening, who is the engineering lead on ANZ's Horizon brand and design system. Today, they will be presenting on creating a human-centered design system that people love to use. Jonathan, Hamish, over to you.
Thank you, Alex. Hello. Welcome, everyone. Johnny and I are super excited to be here and to have you all here. I'm Hamish. I'm a design leader who is passionate about craft and automating workflow to help teams do better work fast. So I'm currently, as Alex said, head of design systems at Carsales, but I have only just started this role. I was working at ANZ for 5.5 years, which we'll be talking about today, some of what we did there. I was involved in the creation of ANZ Horizon, which is ANZ's enterprise brand and design system. And I hope you'll walk away today with some practical learnings on how you can gain and maintain adoption for your design system that you might be having, you might have at your organization. So yeah, Johnny.
All right. Hey, everyone. I'm Johnny. My background is with engineering and design. I'm really passionate about the craft that sits at the intersection of design and technology disciplines. Working in the design system space really lets me scratch that itch. I'm currently engineering lead on ANZ Horizon, and previously at the Red Bank Westpac on the GEL design system. A design system journeys began in the financial services space of banking, working with very large organizations and operating what are commonly referred to as enterprise design systems, centralized initiatives tasked with providing value across the organization as a whole. We're both thrilled to be here to share our story and learnings from our journeys working with design systems.
Cool. So before we get started, I just wanted to say thanks so much to Aquent for having us talk today along with UX Australia. And thanks to everyone who's showed up today. We've been blown away by the response to this talk. The numbers are like off the charts. So yeah, we're really, really excited. And I really hope you get something out of this talk today, whether you're watching live with us or you're viewing the recording afterwards. Like Alex mentioned, This session will be really interactive. So it's not going to be Johnny and I just talking for an hour. We want to hear from you. We want to learn from you, the audience. So please, please contribute to the conversation when we ask. So there are three ways to participate. There's a chat. If we ask you a question, pop your answers down in there. Alex will moderate that. There are reactions you can use, so emoji reactions, which I think a few of you are getting involved with already, which is awesome to see. And then there's a Q&A. So if you've got a question for us, yeah, I can see that. That's cool. Look at those little emojis floating out there. So cute. If you've got a question for us, pop them, put that in the Q&A and just throughout the session, and upvote anything that's interesting you, and we'll get to that at the end. Cool. So Johnny and I are deeply interested in the design system space, how design systems are used, the impacts they have on brand, and how they influence healthy and productive communities at work.
We've been working in the design, in digital for over 15 years across banking, retail, and telecommunications. If there's one thing we've learned over that time, it's that in some cases, our jobs have been more about diplomacy, collaboration, and influence than about design or engineering.
And that is a nice segue into ANZ Horizon. So a little bit on ANZ. Obviously, ANZ is a massive organization, 8.5 million customers across 32 markets, over 28,000 employees, hundreds of digital channels. It's very complex. A multi-layered environment. And it's also the kind of environment that a design system can make a big impact in. So I'm going to share my screen. I want to share a story with you on how Horizon came to be. And this is our Horizon website, which has never been made public before. So Michelle, I think you're on the call. I hope you're okay to be sharing this. But I just wanted to put this up here so everyone can kind of see what we're talking about when we refer to Horizon. This is our Horizon website. Anyway, so how did this all start? So a little story. When I joined ANZ, I joined in the .com team and I saw a big opportunity to automate and systemize our workflow. So I worked with engineers and content people on the design team and everyone really in the team to create this thing called the Living Star Guide, which was, you know, a localized design system for our platform AEM, and it's still used today and it's great. But it's kind of localized to .com. And this wasn't the only kind of grassroots initiatives that sprung up around the time that I started at ANZ. There were other things happening, other system thinkers in the bank that started these initiatives. And after a couple of years, some really switched on execs in Ofer Yom Tov, our chief design officer, and Shweta Mira, the chief marketing officer, really saw the value in creating an enterprise scale design system. So that's when Horizon was born. And they asked Michelle Spencer to head up the team and lead the initiative. And she asked, to my delight, myself to lead the design. So that's really how Horizon was born. That was our homepage. This is the button page. So, you know, that's a little look at what Horizon is. So, Johnny.
Yeah, cool. excuse me. So, we're really keen to hear from you now. So, if you could use the heart emoji if you're working on or using a design system today, that was cool. Or the open mouth emoji if you're not. Wow, look at those hearts. Well, it's happening. Lots of hearts.
I reckon we've got 75% hearts.
Yeah, it's quick.
And a couple of cries and a little bear in there. So that was cool.
All right. So for those of you who work with a design system, who feels or notices friction when working with the business? You can use your mouth open emoji for friction and heart for no friction.
Ooh, a little bit of friction.
With a flip to the mouth open.
Yeah.
All right.
Cool.
That's interesting. maybe not that interesting. Let's get into it some more. All right. So what exactly is a design system? Well, generally speaking, a design system is comprised of standards and guidelines paired with a set of reusable UI assets that help teams create better experiences faster. At ANZ Bank, with Horizon, our brief was to cover marketing comms, both above and below the line, physical and print and branch spaces, human for voice and face-to-face interactions, in a digital with customer and internal facing web applications, mobile apps and websites, where we have focused predominantly thus far.
Cool. So let's look at some examples of design systems in the digital space. So Apple's HIG, human interface guidelines, are probably the most well-known design system out there. So it's basically a set of guidelines and standards and reusable components that make Apple interfaces look and feel like Apple. And it also helps them create those interfaces faster through reuse. Google doesn't want to be left out of the party though, and they've got their material design. I'm sure quite a few of you are familiar with these. Looking beyond digital, the idea of systemizing design for consistency and efficiency extends into all different areas, including automakers. So Audi have a system of sorts that help make their cars feel like a family. They look, feel, and sound the same. And they also have a system to ensure they're manufactured as efficiently as possible. And even NASA want to be part of the act. They've got their NASA graphics standards manual that was first introduced in 1975. Again, consistency of branding, systemization of design, even for rockets. So, you know, it's no mystery, no secret that design systems are making their way into so many organizations these days. And what's great to see is it's extending far beyond technology companies. I mean, if you're a tech company, you kind of have one as a given, but, you know, other organizations are really getting on board. So that's really awesome to see. Johnny, why would we actually need a design system?
Well, for ANZ, the design system exists for two main reasons: to increase efficiency, thus lowering the cost of production, and to increase quality of customer experiences. So we were burning cash, we weren't focused on reuse, and a lot of effort goes into the design and build of one quality component. Your average digital touch point may have around 30 components, and we have hundreds of touch points. It's very inefficient to design and build these from scratch every time. We also lacked consistency in quality, as is common with large organizations. We often have teams working in silos, and this can result in a patchwork quilt of inconsistent and disconnected touch points across channels. We also found brand alignment and accessibility support was often patchy, all of which unfortunately contribute to delivering poor user experiences. So who is the design system for? Well, ideally everyone in the organization. As an enterprise solution, the goal is for Horizon to provide that central source of truth, to be the point of reference for everyone to use across all the touch points we mentioned before. So we've looked at what a design system generally is and what an organization, why an organization might need one, but there's actually more to a design system than the standards, guidelines, and assets definition I used earlier. And that's what brings us to the phrase human-centered design systems, the main theme of our talk today. When you really look at it more broadly, considering the bigger picture, a design system is not an end product. They are not simply a set of asset libraries and guidelines that we, you know, create, maintain, and release to the community. While these are powerful resources and great at addressing efficiency and quality concerns, they're not the be-all and end-all. In reality, these are just pieces of a much larger puzzle. Design systems are really about people, humans. Design systems become human-centered when you put the community who use the system in the center, when we strive to acknowledge and serve the very people that touch the system. These people are fundamental to the success of a design system. So what do they need? What don't they need? And how do you get them to adopt, advocate, and contribute?
Awesome. Thank you, Johnny. Okay, so it's time for everyone on the call to get involved in the discussion. I meant to say earlier as well, I touched on it briefly, but I really want this to be, please don't be shy in contributing to this discussion. Everyone is here to learn, including us. We want to learn as much as we can from you folks. And everyone's at a different stage of their career as well. So some of you may be completely new to design systems. Others may be really well versed in that space, but it is a safe space and there will be no judgments, no silly answers or questions. So I have a question for you, the audience. Do you feel like the design system in your organization caters for the needs of the community and why? So pop your answers to that in the chat down below. And we'll come back to that in a little moment with Alex. Okay, so right now, some of you may be thinking, how does a design system actually become more human-centered? How does it cater for the community's needs? Or you might be thinking, I've built this awesome design system. It's got guidelines, standards, all the assets, Figma libraries, code repos, it's got the works. Isn't that enough to kind of gain and maintain adoption in my organization? Well, we'll be addressing both of these queries if you are thinking them later on. But right now, I want to go back to the chat. And the question, just to recap, was, do you feel like the design system in your organization caters for the needs of the community and why? Alex, do you have?
I'm furiously scrolling here to find, and there's a lot coming through. So hang on a second. Oh, okay. All right, I'm going to go right from the top. So, Lucy, no, the design system we are starting to create is mostly for the designers and the engineers.
Yeah. Interesting.
We have another one from Shadia. Yes, but there are more needs. Also, we have more than one, about 7 to 10 different systems.
Okay.
Yeah, to me sounds like a lot. Is that a lot?
Not always a bad thing. You can have a system of systems, but
at the other end of the scale, we have Felix. Yes, every single component created have gone through rounds and rounds of iteration and usability testing.
Right.
We have Jeanette. We don't currently have one, but I can see huge benefits in terms of consistency, thinking about the end user.
Maybe hit me with one more.
Yeah, one more. Where have I got here? Cool. Yes, we have taken the approach of building our system bottom up rather than top down, building only what is needed.
Awesome.
Sounds good.
Thanks, Alex. That was exceptional moderating.
Sorry to everybody who I didn't get through, which is probably about another 20. Okay, but I'm sure they'll get looked at later.
Yeah. And again, questions in the Q&A as well, if you've got any questions for us. Johnny, do you have a story to share?
Actually, Hamish, I do. I'm going to tell a little story. I'm often asked how large, complex and established organizations like banks manage to get design systems started. It sounds quite like a difficult task, right? So the start of the Westpac gel goes way back. To the beginning of time, before design systems were even a thing. It started as a solution to a CEO's problem. The story goes, button soup. The CEO at the time noticed a considerable number of different button styles across the organization's digital touch points. And as with most interfaces at the time, there was no consistency, no central design language. Customers were having to fend for themselves and navigate a fragmented digital experience. A small team of trailblazing designers were charged with solving this dilemma. Through their solutioning, they somewhat stumbled onto what we commonly call the design system. Consistency across the organization could be created through a central design language, utilized within a set of UI assets to be shared for use by designers and developers. This avoided the need to start from scratch every time, and as a result, dealt with the button soup issue. Stakeholder engagement and buy-in was essential. And by using this early solution as a proof of concept, they could show the value it brings to the organization. And as a result, the team grew to include an engineer. This enabled the move from the original asset library, which was actually based on a simple reskin of Twitter Bootstrap, to move to a more powerful custom multi-brand solution. A central website was crucial to pull it all together, and it included usage guidelines, content around customer centricity, CX design, accessibility, and brand values. This is one story at the start of a design system, but there are now many more across Australia and the globe. Perhaps more important, though, is the story of transition. For many design system teams who come to a point of transition where you need to make a conscious decision about the model you implement going forward to ensure the system is effectively embedded and utilized day to day. And this is what human-centered design systems help to ensure. A Skunkworks type covert operation might be what's required early on, but at a point in time, you're going to need to bring humans into the process and along on the journey. Yeah. So what makes the design system thrive? Before we get into the actual approach we used at ANZ, I want to share with you what we think makes a design system work. And thrown in a few quotes I found for good measure. Operating a well-oiled design system requires you to be transparent. As I've said, you have to bring people on the journey. So share what you're working on and what you're working towards. What's on the, excuse the pun, horizon. The comms are super important. Empathize with the community. You need to understand what the community needs and not let egos get in the way of making lasting relationships. Thirdly, enable the community to give input. Everyone has a right to be heard. As Pat Waters said, when we listen and celebrate what is both common and different, we become wiser, more inclusive, and better as an organization. Design system teams are not the masters of design and engineering, nor the design police. Facilitating collaboration is key. Carolyn Gohn says, collaboration is like carbonation for fresh ideas. Working together bubbles up ideas you would not have come up with solo, which gets you further faster. And also, take a flexible and iterative approach. Things like UI components and guidelines won't be perfect from day one. They may never be. Pivot when you need to, and don't force people to adopt ways of working that frustrates them or slows them down, and be ready to make compromises. For Horizon, in addition to these 4 points, we benefited greatly from having a suite of executive sponsors from the outset. This meant they were taken on the journey with good stakeholder management and could see the value, which led to their mental investment and advocacy from day one. And that's how Horizon thrived. Right, Ham, back to you.
Fantastic. Okay. It's time for some more discussion with the audience. So I have another question. Alex, you're up again. Sorry, mate.
Hey, I'm ready.
In a little bit, actually, sorry. So I'm going to ask the question first. So do you feel like the design system team that you have in your organization that either you're involved with or you work with uses similar methods to what Johnny just outlined? And how successful has that been? So yes, I'm going to tell a little story myself and then we'll come back to those responses shortly. So what happens if we don't kind of follow that approach that Johnny just outlined? I have a bit of a cautionary tale from my time at ANZ. So like I mentioned before, Horizon kicked off. Formerly there were a bunch of grassroots design system movements. And I was really interested in one of these systems and the group that was working on it. It really kind of appealed to me. I felt like it had, you know, real promise. So I got to know the team and I got involved with some of what they were doing. I was always, you know, a little bit on the periphery. But there was one conversation a few months in that really changed my, I guess, my headspace around the system. So the lead of that team told me, you know, in this new world with this new system, this is how you're going to work. You're going to work design purely in the browser, and you're going to be not designing anything new, but you're going to be reusing things that have already been created. And at the time, you know, I felt like there was no better alternative than Figma to create design. You know, it was like, that was where it was at for me. And I was pretty sure there was nothing that was available that was really going to work. And I felt really confident in that position. So, you know, I kind of disengaged. You know, I was like, this is not really where I want to be headed. And, you know, in that moment, in that fleeting moment, that single conversation, I was kind of turned from a promoter of that system into a bit of a detractor, or at least I was a bit lukewarm on it. And this is, you know, this is, I also felt like, you know, lack of empathy. I didn't feel like that designer understood my world, how I worked. So, you know, I was part of the community that that system was there to kind of serve or was vital to its success. Yet I was kind of alienated. So what if the conversation had been different? What if that designer had said to me, I want to understand how you work. I want to understand your world. How can I help you do better work faster? Do you want to be involved more? Do you want to contribute to this thing? These kinds of conversations have a massive impact on the success of a design system with the team. You know, adoption is so key to a design system's success. You know, if no one uses it, what's the point of the system, right?
Yeah,
Johnny, what are your thoughts, mate?
You don't involve the community, your system growth and adoption is going to be very limited. Yeah.
Cool. Alex, I'm going to quickly repeat the question. It was, do you feel like your design system team uses similar methods to what Johnny outlined before, and how successful has it been? Yeah, Alex, do you have anything for us?
Absolutely. Yeah, we've got a few answers on this one. We got some nice right across the spectrum, actually. So first of all, we've got from Sylvia, there isn't much transparency and not a strong ongoing promotion of the DLS. So other areas of the business haven't been taken on the journey. I think that's what's caused a lack of uptake, friction, and awareness.
Great. Yeah, that's really interesting.
Yeah, we've got Jamie here, who's kind of been on a bit of a journey by the looks of it. A very immature design practice within our organization, gone from 3 designers to 17 in a year. And our design system has just been given a name. Our practice has no funding, so we work on other projects, so it's hard for them to dedicate time to working on it when there are competing priorities. However, through various projects and delivering speed to value, we have started to get buy-in from leaders across the business, and more people are beginning to join our Figma instances and try it out. And we also work with across service, UI, UX, and content, so we are all equipped in the skill set to contribute.
Yep, that's what a great story. And yeah, I can totally relate to that one for sure.
Okay. We got Mark who, yes, we take an HCD approach to, we take an HCD approach for effective buy-in from our users, designers and developers, POs and BAs, everyone. Without understanding the needs of our users, we can't create an effective product and service.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
Nice, Mark.
And I've got one here. Do you want one more? From Amir. We have had 10 years to get the process right. We treat it like a product, has a product manager, dedicated devs, documentation, training, and onboarding material. Our challenge is the numerous 20-year legacy products to bring on board.
Mm. Yeah.
I want to learn more about all these systems that people are talking about. It sounds really cool. Sounds like we have some people with some strong experience on the call as well, which is fantastic. Okay, so I wanted to just pause and take a step back and look a little bit into the future. What could design systems look like in, say, 2030? So Johnny and I were discussing this topic, and this idea surfaced around the idea of there being, you know, could there be one system for the whole world to use? You know, one or two systems that dominate and everyone just uses that. Wouldn't that kind of be the ultimate in efficiency and consistency? Would we look back on how, you know, what we were doing today, creating a bespoke systems for each and every organization is kind of a backwards way of doing things that's really inefficient. And the more we kind of thought about it, the more we realized maybe actually it wouldn't work, and here's kind of why. Like Johnny has mentioned before, design systems are much more than technology, assets, content, operations, all the rest. They are intrinsic to the fabric of an organization. They're a culture and a methodology, and you can't take a cookie cutter approach to that stuff. So that said, we do see some more automation in the creation of design systems happening in the future. So much so that, it could be really fast to spin up a design system and apps and services might become almost throwaway goods because it's so fast to create those experiences. We also see the systemization of more broader experiences going beyond components, patterns, pages to full actual end-to-end journeys. We also see the role of design system teams changing inside of organizations, more from experts and with specialist knowledge to enablers. Communities will have more ownership over their system inside of organizations, and systems thinking will be embedded right to the core. We also see the growing influences of design tokens or a similar concept growing even further. But it's time to stop there. We have looked at what makes a design system thrive in an organization and maybe what doesn't make a design system thrive. We looked at what might happen in the future. But what worries me is that Australia will be left behind if we don't change our mindset and behaviors around how we create design systems. We're not going to be able to keep up with the Silicon Valleys and the New Yorks of the world if we don't address our behaviors. Design systems and design in Australia will go backwards if we don't address the needs of the community. We get lost in the world of design abstraction. If we don't see ourselves as conveners and collaborators and mediators, if we don't see ourselves as leaders influencing core business operations and productivity, and if we don't see ourselves as, if we don't advocate for design systems as critical platforms for collaboration, if we don't do these things, if they don't happen, we're going to be recreating buttons over and over for years to come. Okay, now I've got that off my chest. Let's look at Keynote, shall we? Bear with me. Okay, so here are the three human-centered design methodologies that made ANZ's Horizon a success. And a little shout out to the audience again. Would love to know if any of you are using any of these methods today, and what other methods you're using as part of your design system that have been a success. So while I'm going through this, if you've got any thoughts, chuck them in the chat and we'll come back to those after this little piece. Okay, so our first thing we did when Horizon kicked off. And, Siri needs to go away. First thing we did as part of Horizon, Siri just made an unwelcome entrance to the webinar, getting some lols, that's cool. We could have just put our heads down, right? We could have just locked ourselves away and created a whole bunch of components and Figma libraries and guidelines and standards and built something beautiful, but we would have missed the first opportunity to bring the community along the journey. So instead, we went around and we actually talked face-to-face with about 70 people from across the organization of different backgrounds. And we really took the time to listen. I think this is, here we go, there's a photo. That's Michelle, our initiative lead on the left, and Triska, key stakeholder. This is a non-staged photo. This is not staged.
Whatever.
So yeah, we really took the time to listen and we really wanted to understand the needs and pain points of the community and hear their feelings. What are their feelings about systems? You know, there was, you know, it was all pretty new and people were just, you know, there was a few, you know, there's mixed feelings, I think, in the organization. And we also wanted to know what advice they had for us. We ended up with thousands of data points, which we, this is me in a like room full of post-it notes, lost in a world of post-it notes. We synthesized all these data points into themes. And these themes informed the principles on how we worked as a design system team, what we wanted to our design system to embody. And it really helped with early stage adoption. That, you know, really kicked off adoption for us. People watched, you know, people were engaged, people were watching what we were doing right from the very start. So yeah, I feel like the Horizon had a really good start in the world. Johnny, over to you.
Yeah, right. Well, secondly, with Horizon, we empower the community to contribute. Just quickly on community, it's coming up a lot in the chat. We do mean like the community within the organization. Obviously, a large organization as we've been working with, it's a very broad set of people that become that community. Obviously, outside of that, we have customers that we're servicing through what we create. So yeah, I can see there's a little bit of confusion coming through. But yeah, let's look at this in a little bit more detail. So with Horizon, most of the components, often the guidelines, also they're designed by designers and delivery squads because they're the ones that are best placed to solve for this space after all. The process goes a little something like this. So the designer designs the component, including any usability testing in the context of the work that they're doing. Then Horizon helps to ensure that the component meets the design standards. The community then assesses the design and gives input in what we call a design study. And Hamish will share more on that shortly. The designer then iterates on the design if necessary. Thirdly, the Horizon team then writes the guidelines in partnership with the delivery team, builds the component, adds it to the Figma library, documents everything for the Horizon website, and shares updates with the community via newsletters and through internal chat channels. We're also always looking to uplift and enhance our components so we understand you know, what's working and what's not. So looking into team structure, the Horizon team is made up of a core group of around 8 people. They represent design ops, engineering, brand content, and our initiative lead, Michelle Spencer. Except for engineering, core team members are also embedded in other teams throughout the bank. This approach really helps the design system team keep a finger on the pulse, actively involved in the greater community and closer to the action. It also allows team members to influence and contribute into their respective business areas directly, providing systems thinking and helping with adoption. Hamish, do you want to tell us more about design study?
Sure thing, yeah. Maybe before I do, is everyone clear on the what we mean when we refer to the community? Just maybe a thumbs up or...
Yeah, cool.
Yep, seems like we got a few thumbs ups. Yep. Okay.
All thumbs up.
Oh, yep. Very good. Yay. Cool. Sorry about the confusion. Okay. Design study. This is probably one of my favorite methods we use to work with the community during Horizon. I was thinking it was also probably the most productive and long standing. It's still going today. Method we used, activity. So it's, you know, it's how we basically maintained that buy-in with the community that we got at the start when we did that needs based discovery research. So the format of design studies is really straightforward. It's just basically just a design critique using Rose, Thorn, Bud in Figma. And it's basically anyone can attend design study. And anyone who is looking to contribute something to Horizon, whether it's a designer, an engineer, or a content person, could be guidelines, could be code, could be component designs. Often it was kind of component designs because that's where we were at. They bring that design, let's use the component design as an example. They bring that component design to design study, and everyone just comes from different areas of the organization and they come and they give their feedback on that component. And basically, we just go through all the points of feedback and discuss them. And what ends up happening is that for the community, they get a chance to bring their unique perspective, their unique point of view. And they feel like they've got skin in the game and they're part of the conversation. Part of them is in Horizon. For us, the team on Horizon, we get a chance to stress test the design. Make sure it's as flexible and robust and scalable as it can be. And we're not just solving for one specific space. We need to solve for the enterprise, remember. So this is one of the activities on how we that enabled us to make sure that we're solving for the enterprise and not just one space. Johnny.
Yeah, also I think what worked well was that we looked to form alliances. So yeah, early on in the journey, we looked to form alliances with users and teams within the community that would benefit from the success of the design system. We asked who's doing the same work already. We looked at across different disciplines, and obviously brand, content engineering, design, ops, etc. We looked in different areas within the organization. Also, we looked for individuals who were keen to get involved, and we brought people in who are passionate about systems thinking and use the momentum that was, you know, already there in the organization. Worked really well, really well. Do you want to go to a recap now, Hamish?
Yes, let's do it. So you hear the three HCD methods that made Horizon successful. I've just looked at the time and we're actually pretty good, but I want to keep moving. So I'm going to get out of keynote world and throw to Alex. Just the question was that we asked, is anyone using the methods that we just talked about today? What other methods are you using and how successful have they been for you? Alex, do you have anything for us?
Cool. We've got a few coming in on that. Not specifically answering those at the moment.
That's cool. You know what we can do? Should we go to Q&A after some closing remarks and then we can get stuck into that. I think that's this seems like some.
We've got lots of Q&As coming through on all kinds of.
Yeah. All right. Let's move forward. Johnny.
Yeah, cool. Well, to wrap up, as Hamish and I have been on our design system journeys, we've come to realize, I think most importantly, that design systems are the culture. They're a journey an organization goes on. Design systems are a bunch of people that come together and agree to work together in a certain way. There are hundreds, maybe even thousands of correct answers in getting to a solution that serves multiple parties in an organization. Design system team members are the custodians of this human-centered endeavor. They are facilitators of the conversation.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, Johnny. Culture is just so important. If we want Australia to be a leader in the design system space, we as a design community really need to step up and be the custodians of collaboration. As designers, it's our nature, it's our strength. So we need to lead and we need to be open to change. So I'm asking you to step back from your day-to-day and ask yourself, am I focused on the needs of the community that I'm here to serve, or am I lost in a world of design abstraction? Cool. I just wanted to quickly fire up Keynote just to thank a couple of people quickly who helped make this happen. Thanks so much to Dominic, Anthony, Michelle, Off Air, Shweta, and Shane. You're all amazing. I also want to thank my wife, who's been really amazing in supporting me on this journey. Ashley, you're amazing. Please feel free to connect with us on the socials. So yeah, LinkedIn's and Twitter's, etc. Yay. Okay. Should we jump into Q&A world?
Yes, we've got a few Q&A's here. I've got a, this came up in a few different questions. Okay, so I'm gonna paraphrase about four or five different questions here. How do you avoid design by committee, too many cooks, decisions not being made, too many inputs in decisions? Was basically a theme that came through on about four or five different from four or five different people there.
That's an awesome question. Johnny, do you mind if I take this one, mate?
Yeah, go for it.
Yeah, so that was something we were super conscious of. You know, going the extra mile with the community does add a little bit of time up front, maybe, but it pays off in the long run in my experience. That said, you do need to structure the right activities to get the right information out of your community. And we did experiment with a few different activities, but at the end of the day, design study was a good way to field a whole bunch of data from the community, process that data and work out, okay, this is what we need to implement now. This is what we might want to implement later. And here's frankly what we can ignore for the moment. So that allowed us to cut through, just get cut through and keep moving and gain and have momentum, not get kind of tangled up in the weeds of feedback. Yeah. And design by committee, because that's not good for anyone really.
Okay, thank you. Another question. How have you gauged the success of Horizon?
Good question. Johnny, do you want to answer? Or?
I was thinking you're probably better placed having, you know, been in the business for longer.
Yeah, so we had to really show value to different levels of the organization. The execs, they kind of wanted to know about the dollar figures. So Michelle really focused, along with, you know, input from us, on how we show our return on investment. And it wasn't just for the current year, it was forecasted into many years down the track. So that was the message that we tailored for the executive folks and the senior business leaders. And then for people, other designers, we really focused on what we could give to them. So we showed how many things we're creating, how many reusable things we were creating, and showed the efficiencies that were gained through using those things. So we used survey data to show that we're getting some really great efficiencies with the teams that were using Horizon. We used that data to then sell to other teams to say, hey, you could be part of this, you can move fast like this team. So it was really about, you know, it wasn't just one message. It was, the message was tailored for different audiences.
Cool. Thank you. Got a question here. Not sure who it's from. It's coming through anonymous. How do you perceive the level of innovation of your thinking and design when everything has to be standardized and consistent to design systems? Can you find innovation within uniformity?
Yeah. For me, I think so, based on, sure, open it out and allow everyone to be super, super creative, but you're allowing the whole design community to just kind of create inconsistency, which has a flow on effect to customers, right? So the tool set of some things that are reusable help to bring consistency in giving you the smaller pieces to allow for design to, you know, pull together some bigger things you can solve for. Yeah. Bigger problems than obviously the common term of like buttons. Who wants to create buttons forever? That's how I'd take that, Hamish.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think, you know, design systems enable creativity, enable you to focus on the bigger problems, journeys, even motion and micro interactions and edge cases, all the stuff that gets, you know, and accessibility, all the stuff that gets kind of pushed aside when you spend time creating bespoke, you know, components and stuff. So I think it's an enabler of creativity. It's just about the approach we take to it, really. Yeah.
Cool. Good stuff. A question here. Where would be the best place to learn more about creating design systems?
Johnny?
There's so much content online. Design systems are massive. I can't even say right now. They have been for some time. There's plenty of great content out there. Hamish, can you recommend some?
Yeah, look, I mean, there's just a ton of articles. Yeah. It's really about what you need. I know that there's an agency, Super Normal, that have like a massive long 50 item to-do list. It's like you know, the first 30 days of your design system or something, and that just lists everything that they think you should do and when you want to set up a design system. But I think, you know, you need to kind of source your information from different corners of the internet, because you can't take a cookie cutter approach to this stuff. I looked at that list and I was like, yeah, I'll do that. But it's not, you know, not everything here is going to work for where I am now, which is car sales. So I've just, you know, looked at the problems that I'm facing in my organization and how design system might solve them, and then seek out the information that is relevant to me at that moment. Just Google.
Also reach out to people. Like, there are a number of people that sort of stand out in the industry. There are, you know, groups, meetups that I'm not sure if still exist, but, you know, pre-COVID, there were some pretty active meetups happening around design systems.
And Twitter is really awesome as well. I've just curated a pretty solid design systems Twitter feed that just I stay up to date on everything. It's up to the minute kind of stuff. So that's been really helpful as well.
I'll also give a quick plug to Aquent Gymnasium there as well, which is a free online training platform which has a training course on design systems in there.
Yes, well. And there are lots of training courses as well. So there's one by Dan Moore which I've signed up for. I haven't actually watched yet, but it looked really good. Yeah. Cool.
I've got another question here from Lindsay, slightly different tack, but it's something you referred to earlier. How do you find the design systems in Australia different from the Silicon Valley? What makes their design systems better?
Johnny?
I potentially say that in some cities, some locations, maybe there's a bit more maturity within the organization and how it's utilized. A little bit more of a larger understanding of the value that it brings. Perhaps, as we often see in Australia, we're maybe a little bit behind. I'd
talk to that. I don't think we're like super far behind. No. I think Atlassian, one of the leaders, one of the best design systems out there. It probably comes a little bit down to budget and sourcing the right talent. You know, there's not a lot of talent necessarily that are specialists in the design system space throughout the world. So I don't think we're doing too bad.
Cool. Yes, sir. And I've got a couple of questions that are coming through on how do you measure the financial ROI on a design system?
That's a good question. Was basically down to some calculations we did around efficiencies based on a survey. And then it was basically, we used some math to work out, okay, if this year, if we get X number of people using this system based on this investment, this is the efficiencies we'll gain. These are the cost savings in productivity. And then we kind of looked, we forecasted that into the future, and we showed that, okay, with the similar or even less investment next year and the year after, the actual efficiency gains or savings will be kind of exponential. So it showed with a little bit of investment up front, and ongoing, we get that exponential ROI in efficiencies. So you know, it's really hard to measure quality. We struggled to kind of work out a way to really measure the quality, you know, impacts of design systems. I'd love to know if anyone has experimented in that world. Efficiencies were a lot easier for us to measure.
I think if you are trying to do that, don't get caught up in trying to do that accurately. It's going to be a very difficult task. Find a way that works, I guess, for your organization, and use that as your, you know, magical number to sort of see that scale, because you know there's benefit in doing so.
Yeah, and we found surveys was the most accurate way to surveys of the community, the people who were using Horizon. That was the most accurate way to get a view on the efficiencies, rather than going into the tech repos and Figma libraries and attributing, you know, Figma inserts or tech every time the components used in a tech repo. It was that was a bit of a murky world for us in our world. So just to get a read on that stuff and put a dollar value to it. So yeah, surveys worked for us.
Cool. Great stuff. I think we've probably got time for one more question. There's been a couple that have come through on this around technology, in terms of what technology could you use to build a design system? Maybe what would you recommend?
Johnny?
Well, I guess it's technology the whole way through. You've got designers using technology to do their design process. That seems to be a thing that changes semi-frequently. It's a number of different packages that designers like at the moment, and some probably do a better job than others. Obviously, at the other end, getting it through into production, you can't, I think, really say there's one technology that you must use when you're building your, if we're talking component libraries. It's a big decision. It's an organizational decision around the technologies that are required for that organization. React would by far be the most commonly used piece of technology to create components for use in an interface. I guess there's probably other things I could talk to as well, like prepackaged solutions that allow you to scale them out quickly, but leave that for another day.
Yeah, it's also, you know, just leveraging what is in play, you know, as well. But, you know, in the design space, I mean, Figma's an enterprise tool, which was fantastic. And we're lucky enough to be able to spin up a custom, you know, guidelines website. But, you know, at Carsales at the moment, we have a zero height website. So it's just, different strokes for different organization folks.
Good stuff. Okay. Right, we're getting to that point. I think we should probably bring this to a wrap. I know we say an hour, so let's keep it at that. But I think we could have gone on for a lot longer than we had a lot of questions and stuff. So firstly, on behalf of everybody on this call, I'm pretty sure and everyone's going to agree, and I can already see from the emojis coming up, thank you to Jonathan and Hamish for that. That was fantastic. Thank you for the work you put in, sharing your insights and your knowledge and everything. It was absolutely brilliant. Thank you also to everybody for joining and making this such a great event. We really do appreciate your participation. And this is by far the most interactive DigiTalks we've had, and it worked a treat. So it was really good. So thank you to everybody for that. Thank you to UX Australia for having DigiTalks as part of the event program again. And last but not least, we do these DigiTalks, we do them 3 or 4 times every year. We want to keep making them better and better. And the way we do that is by getting feedback from everybody. So there is a feedback form that pops up at the end of this when this is closed off. It's about what went well, what could be done better, and what would you like to hear about next in terms of DigiTalks. So we'll make sure that we can hit that. But again, Johnny, Hamish, thank you so much. Thank you, everybody. Look forward to seeing you all next time.